What's up, guys? This is a clip from episode 43 with Gene Belmades and Digital Jeff. And this is Gene telling that crazy story of linking Laredo to JFK's assassination, potentially. This is pretty crazy, and it kind of prompted me to track down the owner of one of the objects that will be told in this story. But anyways, check this out. Also, go back and listen to the episode. Great episode. A little bit of an insight into the political atmosphere in Laredo during Gene's tenure there. And it's just overall good episode, great stories. Anyways, here it is. Check it out.
Is this the human race of the future?
Aliens on the border.
But conspiracies, you know, hey, there's a lot of stuff goes on. I mean,
I was about to say I want to take a hard left turn into that and jump into one of the stories that Jeff had told me that you know that involves JFK and Laredo.
It does, and it's an interesting story because there are four people, I believe, that are still alive today that know that story, that were witnesses to what the story is. So go back in time, November 22nd, 1963. It's late in the evening. There's a couple guys that are bellhops. They're in college, high school and college, and they're working at La Posada, the famous La Posada, and the original building, not the West Patio was built in the 80s. The original building is what you see right across from San Agustin Plaza. And they encounter a man who is completely inebriated. He's drunk as a skunk. He's passed out on the staircase of the main building, going to the rooms where you have, if anybody's ever been to La Posada, they know that the San Agustin Ballroom is to the east of the hotel, and there is a sky bridge that you walk across to get to it. Well, there's a staircase that goes down to the goes down to the parking garages and up to the second floor. Well, this individual is down in between the parking garage and that first floor, and he's completely passed out. He's got a bottle of liquor in one hand and a pistol in the other, and he's completely out cold. And so the bellhops run and tell the night manager. The night manager says, "Oh, this is what we're going to do. We're going to help him back into his room. We find out who he is. They put him in a room, put him back to bed comfortably, take his pistol, put it in the safe, and left it at that. No one knew any better. Next morning, they go to check on him, and he's gone. Whoa. He's checked out, right? But he didn't go to the front desk. He's basically, you know, in those days, you have a ledger. Everything's written in pencil and a ledger, and the night auditor checks in, you know, it sends the housekeepers to clean up the room, and he's gone. So nothing is said. Nothing is done. They keep his pistol. They try to find his name, but obviously it becomes apparent to them that this is an alias, that this person can't be found anywhere. It didn't have all the proper documentation. So a couple days go by, and the hotel, even in the 60s, to this day, they still do it. They have what's called a deep clean. They'll go into that room, they'll strip all the sheets, they strip it down to the beds, they go in and they hard clean every room if they're vacant. And in this particular check, they lifted up the mattress, and in between the mattress of that guy's room is a rifle.
Whoa.
And again, they pull it out, put it in the safe. No one makes a big deal about it. Weeks go by. They still can't get the guy. So almost a couple years go by before the owner of the hotel, his son, decides to take the rifle home, takes the pistol home, and he puts it in his safe at home. Years later, when the Warren Commission is now finished its investigation, they start to show all the pictures of this gentleman who is accused of shooting JFK, and he holds up that rifle, and the guy that owns the hotel looks at it and says, "Hey, I've got that rifle, the exact same rifle, in my safe."
Whoa. Wow.
And so he alerts law enforcement. Law enforcement wants to take the rifle from him, but he refuses to let it go. Again, there's no reason. They've got no reason to take it from him. It's speculation at this point, so he and his lawyer craft up a way to make sure they don't take it. They don't take it, and they keep it. But November 22nd was the night they killed JFK.
Yeah.
And if you think about it for a moment, straight shot from Dealey Plaza 35 to Laredo, Texas.
Yeah.
But you get here and the bridge is closed.
Yeah.
National emergency.
Dang.
So you can't get across. You're stuck at La Posada, panicked that they're going to find you. So you drink yourself blind. You fall asleep in the staircase.
Got a gun with you.
You got a gun.
Dang.
You hide your rifle, the rifle that could have, maybe was used for the second shooter, and you bury it in the room. Next morning, you're in such a hurry, you realize you can't cross to the other side with a rifle. In Mexico, even in the 60s, guns and bullets were illegal, so...
Whoa, that's crazy.
Yeah.
He leaves it.
He just disappears.
And then years later, the guy is looking at the same rifle that Lee Harvey Oswald was holding and says, I have the exact same rifle in my gun safe.
That's so insane.
There are four people who are alive today. Two brothers, the son of the owner of that hotel, and one of the auditors that was there that night. Wow. That are still alive to verify that story.
Holy crap.
Wow.
That's... What? How did you come across this story?
The person who told me the story was a long-standing general manager for the hotel. I had the opportunity when I took over the position of director of sales and marketing to hire him back to be kind of our community liaison and a salesperson within the organization, because he had such a wealth of knowledge of the history of the hotel. And we were rebranding it at the time. This is when we changed, redid the logos in dark black and gold and cleaned them all up, kind of modernized it. They had a major renovation going at the hotel that year, and they brought in a whole bunch of new staff. The hotel had been losing money for years, and so bringing him in, we got to sit around with him often and just talk about, La Posada and its glory days when, all the movie stars came in, the Steve McQueens of the world and the John Schneiders and all the others and the Duvals that all came to the hotel at some point, all the Mexican artists, the presidents, the Governor Bush, all the people along the course of years that he was general manager that showed up at that hotel and that long history. Well, in that, there's some ghost stories that came out of that. And there was this particular story. And that one has stuck with me for forever. And every time I see him, I remind him of that story and how it's still fresh in my brain when he told it.
Yeah.
Because you think about conspiracies.
And that's one
it's
of the,
plausible.
Yeah.
Very
yeah.
plausible.
That's kind of like the event that coined the term
conspiracy
theory.
Yeah. Another thing is, like, just for the listeners, like, La Posada is located right next to the bridge, right?
Right.
It's
right next door to the bridge. It's literally up against us.
Like a block away.
Over, the west patio there. Now is just right up against it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it's a block away.
Yeah.
It's one block west, one block south, and you're already going into Mexico.
Damn. Yeah.
So if you ran or if you drove yourself all the way down from Dealey Plaza down 35, it's about a seven hour drive. Yeah. And if you're hauling it down here, by the time he got here, it was too late. Bridges, national emergency, and the bridges had closed. And there's this guy trapped.
Can't leave Laredo.
And nobody ever was able to identify him, right? Just disappeared.
Yeah. Spook.
Follow us on Instagram at AOTB_cast, on Twitter at AOTB.cast. Check us out on Facebook. That's facebook.com/AOTBcast. Email us your questions, comments, anything at AOTB.cast@gmail.com. And as always, subscribe and give us those 5-star reviews.